Hi, my name is Garek Snorifiles, and my pronouns are they, them, she, him. It is about time we had a damn theme song. Come on! Yes, sir. Listen, do you want a revolution? I say, do you want a revolution? Today, we're going to talk about Stormé DeLarverie. Stormé DeLarverie was a Black non-binary drag king based in New York City. Stormé DeLarverie was born in New Orleans, Louisiana, to a wealthy white father and a Black mother in the 1920s. However, when she was born, she did not have any record of her birth. In fact, she didn't have a birth certificate. And so what she says is that she was born on Christmas Eve in 1920. So Stormé is very fair. She's an extremely light-skinned woman. She would get beat up a lot by the white kids at school. Stormé said she was beat up by the white kids because she was a Negro with a white face. And it got so bad that her father sent her away to a private school. When she was about 18 years old, that's when she realized that she was a lesbian and that she was attracted to women. And she says that she was afraid to stay in New Orleans because of the crime that was inflicted on LGBTQIA bodies, and so she moved to Chicago. She rode jumping horses side saddle for the Ringling Brothers Circus, which is a huge circus company in the United States, and I believe it still exists today. She had to stop riding horses due to a very bad injury from a fall. When she moved to Chicago, she performed as Stormé Dale, and she would dress as a woman and sing jazz music on stage. She said that there was a time where she was dressed as a woman, and she was stopped by a police officer on the street. And the police officer thought that she was a drag queen, and she had to explain to him, like, no, I'm not a drag queen, I'm just dressed. Because, you know, back in the day, it was actually illegal for men to dress up as women, or people who identified as a man to dress up as a woman. When she got a bit older, she performed with the Jewel Box Review, which was a performance review who actually did drag performance. Back in the day, they called it gender deception performance. And she would perform with this troupe in New York City at the Apollo Theater very often. Her title in this drag performance review was called The One Girl. She performed this song called A Surprise with a Song, in which she would do a beautiful reveal. She would start off in masculine drag king look, and she would reveal herself to be this high femme woman. It was extraordinary. When Stormé would perform, she would wear top hats, masculine clothing, three-piece suits tailored to the gods, and she made an extraordinarily handsome man. This brings us to June 1969 in New York City at the Stonewall Inn. So remember when I told you that a person who was assigned female at birth had to wear at least three articles of feminine clothing while they were out in public spaces? Well, Stormé was at the Stonewall Inn, and she was dressed in her typical three-piece suit, and she was stopped by a police officer in front of the Stonewall Inn, and the police officer questioned her. One thing led to another, and the police officer smacked Stormé over the head with a billy club. Stormé said she had a wound on her head and was just gushing from it, and that out of reflex, she's popped the policeman in his face. He handcuffed her and was escorting her to the paddy wagon. While she was being escorted to the paddy wagon, she looks out at all the queers who were in the space just watching this transpire, and she's like, why don't you do something? This is what sparked the Stonewall Rebellion. Was it a shoe? Was it Marsha P. Johnson's brick? Who knows? But this is supposed to be the very first impetus that night of what sparked the Stonewall riots. Stormé says that it was not a riot, but it was a rebellion. It was an act of disobedience that they were saying, enough is enough. We are not going to allow these police officers to come in here, tell us what we're allowed to wear, tell us what to do, and come and constantly take money, because I told you before how the police officers were working with the mafia. This event marked Stormé with the name of the gay community's Rosa Parks. Mind you, Stormé was 48 years old at the time. After Deanna, Stormy's partner, passed, Stormé stopped performing. However, she became a huge force within the LGBTQIA community in New York City. She was a bodyguard, she was a bouncer at the Cubbyhole and at the Stonewall Inn as well. She was one of the founding members of the Stonewall Veterans, and she held the title Chief of Security, Ambassador, and later she would become the Vice President. She said that she was always on the lookout, ready to take out anyone who was trying to attack her baby girls and her baby boys, because she said, we're all in this together. She also performed at fundraisers and events for families and women who experienced abuse and domestic violence. She was called the gay superhero or the lesbian superhero because she was a vigilante. She made sure that she stayed out on the streets to make sure that folks who were there, who were living their truth, were being able to be protected. In her obituary in the New York Times, she was called the guardian of the West Village. She was also called the butch who ignited the Stonewall riots. She was described to be a typical butch New York lesbian. On June 7th, 2012, she was honored at the Brooklyn Society for Ethical Culture. In June 2019, she was the inaugural 50 pioneers, trailblazers, and heroes inducted onto the National LGBTQ Wall of Honor within the Stonewall National Monument in New York City. This monument is the first LGBTQIA monument and remembrance structure to ever have been erected in the United States. If you want to check out more on Stormé DeLarverie, you can go to this film that was made in the 1980s called The Lady of the Jewel Box. Who threw the first punch at Stonewall? Was it somebody? Was it a myth? Who fucking cares? There is always all of this discussion about who threw the first stone or who ignited the Stonewall riots. This idea that in order for us to embrace our history, we need to know all of the guaranteed facts of it. But I also think it's important to have figures who can be mythologized, such as Stormé DeLarverie, because after all, we Black trans people need superheroes too. Thank you so much for watching. Please don't forget to like, share, follow, and save. It really helps to get the information out there and to bring people to this history because you know it's important. I will see you again next Sunday. Have a great Sunday, and remember, you are the revolution.